If you remember, we said any vector space that we have, we can describe this vector space by using bases. What are the bases of the vector space? We said that vectors v1 till vn are bases of vector space V if we have these two conditions. One, V is a span by V1, V2 till Vn. Two, what was the second condition? They have to be linearly independent. V1 and Vn are linearly independent. Now, these bases were very important because any vector that we pick up in V, we can represent it as addition of these series of bases. You remember the most famous one, for instance, in Cartesian are I, J, and K vectors. Now, also, we said the dimension of the vector space are the number of bases that we have. So, we continue by talking about rank of a matrix. What is the rank of a matrix? I give you a definition, then we stop. We continue with talking about some other stuff. And then after I introduce you a few new things, we will get back to this definition of rank and we will try to relate the things that we have studied. So what is the rank of a matrix? Any rank 1 matrix A can be written as XY transpose. So if A belongs to R m by n, now if A is m by n, what can we say about the size of the dimension of R? It belongs to R what? R m. What about y? Y is another common vector which is n. So it will be n by 1 multiplied by n by 1 transpose, which is y by n, the result is n by n. If A was belonging to the complex n by n, then x would belong to cm and y would belong to cn. And this formula will be x, y, conjugate transpose, Hermitian. You may remember it from the first lecture when we were talking about the transpose and Hermitian. Question. What does it mean? What is rank 1? What is rank 1 and why is it true?
if 90 is equal to 1 of a matrix, what does it mean?
Nastya?
There is only one independent column.
The other columns in this matrix, or the other rows in this matrix, are actually a linear combination of this first one.
Well, how linear combination? This is, look at the values of y. It's like values of y have been multiplied by this column vector x. That's why we call it rank 1. And note 2, any rank 1 symmetric matrix A belongs to R m by m can be written as A is equal to x transpose, where x belongs to Rm. Again, if you want, you can write it as a complex form, so it will be x permission. Now, we keep the rank here, and we proceed. We will talk a bit about addition and intersection between subspaces. We will talk about direct sum. We will talk about the transformation, linear transformation, and then we will get back to this definition again. But in order to continue, you need to know a few more things. We have talked about subspaces, so we understand what the subspace of vector space is, right? How can I understand that we have a subspace? What was the property of the subspace? How many properties did we have to satisfy? Two. One of them was addition. If S is a member of subspace, if T is a member of the subspace, the addition is also a member of subspace. The other one is that if you have a constant, you multiply it by S, it will be still a member of subspace. Now, what we want to talk now, we want to talk about the intersection of subspaces and the addition of subspaces. So, the title will be Sum and Intersection of Subspaces. Given the vector space V over the field F, then for R and S be a subspace of V, we have these two. One, the addition is defined as the value of R plus value of S, where R belongs to R and S belongs to S. And intersection of R and S is the value like W, which W belongs to R, and W, as we can expect, belongs to S. And clearly, R plus S is still a subspace of V, a subset of V, and R intersection S also is a subspace of V. Why? Because if R belongs to R, if R belongs to R, it means that R also belongs to V, right? S belongs to S, it means that S belongs to V. Because V is a vector space, if I pick up any two members, addition of them must be also a member of V. So it means that R plus S are in V. Similar thing, similar conclusion can come out for intersection. If W is in R, it means W is also in V. If W is in S, it means W is also in V. So it means W is a member of V. Note that union of the subspaces is not necessarily a subspace. So union is not necessarily subspace. R, we define this type of summation, plus S is called direct sum. It's a direct sum. In which we have these two important properties. One, R intersected by S is empty, is zero. Two, we define the result T to be R plus S. So direct S, direct sum, is when we have no intersection between the two subsets. From maybe higher school probability, you may remember this. Do you remember the Venn diagram? You know, we were saying that we have the sample space S and we have the group A. Do you remember it? And you tell me if A intersected by B is empty and A plus B is equal to S. What was the name of B?
Inverse.
Not inverse. Something else. Mama? Can't remember it?
Complement.
It's called complement of A. So B was A prime or A complement or A bar. Why? Because they have nothing to intersect and intersect is empty. Why we call it complement is because together they will complete whole set. So we call it complement. Now look at here. Look at here. R and S have nothing in common, and when I add them, they make a big set, right? So R is called the complement of S in T. Or you can say that S is a complement of R in T. Listen. Why call it complement? Because they have nothing in common, and when we add them, we get the whole T. Note. Complement of R in T, or complement of S in T, is not unique. But later, possibly on Tuesday, we will learn that the orthogonal complement of R in T is unique.
So the complement is not necessarily unique, but the orthogonal complement is definitely unique. Now, assume that we have T, which is the direct sum of RLS. Assume that R is direct sum of R and S, then for any T belonging to T, there is a unique expression T is equal to R plus S, where R belongs to R and S belongs to S, and two, the dimension of T is equal to the dimension of R plus the dimension of S. So let's see, let's prove and see why this expression, these terms are true. First part. Assume we cannot uniquely describe it. In other words, assume T is R1 plus S1, which is equal to R2 plus S2, where R1 and R2 are in R, and S2 are in S. Now, from this part, what I get is this. R1 minus R2 is equal to S2 minus S1. Right? If we understand that R and S are subset, right? What was the definition of subset? If I have one element in S, if I have another element in S, their addition is also in S, right? So R1 is in R. R2 is in R. The difference is also in R. So this belongs to R. S2 minus S1 also belongs to? So what do we get from this conclusion? What do we conclude from this? A member in R is equal to a member in X. What do we conclude from this?
They have intersection.
So we conclude R intersect S is not empty. Which is? Which is wrong. So, why is it wrong? Because we have direct sum, because T is direct sum, and the condition 1. It should be empty. So, because this is wrong, it means the assumption is wrong. So, which means that we can uniquely write the T as addition of R plus S. So this assumption that no, we cannot, is wrong. So, the proof is done in here. For the second part, we need to know the general formula. Did you get it? Did you get the point? It says that if this is a direct sum, we can uniquely describe
any element of T as addition of an RMS. But in order to prove, he said that let's assume we can't. In other words, there are more than one way of representing the value of T. And as a result, we got that then it means that we should have R intersection S not empty. Which is wrong, because otherwise this is not a direct sum. And then it means that the hypothesis that we had, which was like not unique to describing, is wrong. Now for the second part, it says that the dimension of T is equal to dimension of R plus dimension of S. We have to use this rule. Note, dimension of R plus S is dimension of R plus dimension of S minus dimension of R intersected by S. This is the general formula. Now, if T is direct sum of R and S, then dimension of T, which is dimension of direct sum of R and S, is equal to the dimension of R plus dimension of S minus dimension of R intersected by S. Kathy, what is the dimension of R intersected by S? It's empty, zero, so dimension of R plus dimension of S, and the proof of the second part is also complete. Any question up now? Linear transformation. Suppose V over F and W over F are vector spaces. F is the field. Then N is the linear transformation on V over W if and only if L of alpha V1 plus beta V2 is equal to alpha 1 L of V1 plus beta L V2. So what happens from V, from V vector space V, we go to vector space W. V is called domain, and W is called codomain. W is called codomain. So from domain, we go to the range, the codomain. Again, you might be very familiar with the concept of linearity. We consider an operator is linear if it is, if the addition of two things and then you apply the operator is the same as you apply the operator on each of them and then add them. And if you multiply a constant with a theorem and then you apply the operator, is the same as you apply the operator on the theorem and then you multiply by the scalar. So both of these properties, scaling and addition, are in one formula in here that we have. Now, you remember we talked about the basis, right? At the beginning, even we defined the basis. And we said the most famous one is that we have in Cartesian, I, J, and K. Because people are using them, so it's kind of an S-number. But in one vector space, we do not necessarily have one single way of representing basis. So what we want to talk is about change of basis in vector space. Basis in vector space. Assume that for vector space V over the field F, usually we use R, it's simpler, but it can be anything. We have the basis, we have a basis V1 of the Vn and E1 of the Vn. So we have two sets of basis. What was the meaning of basis? I have a vector space whose bases are V1, V2, till Vn. What does it mean?
We can explain all of the
Vn. What does it mean? I'm going to see is that in Cartesian coordinates, we have the bases are I, J, and K.
We can explain all
of the Vn.
No,
she's not a person, I'm sure.
Those are the x, the y, and the answers.
So what does it mean?
And we can represent them by means of...
Any vector can be represented, as also Fatman stated, any vector can be represented by linear combination of I, j's, and k's. By linear combination, we mean it can be multiplied by a number, it can be added. So, thus, a vector u can be represented as c1, v1, cn, vn, right? But also, e1, e2, till en are my bases. So it means that my vector u can be written as, let's say, b1, e1, it'd be n, en. Is it true? Because we said that. We have two sets of bases. This one and this one. Imagine we have like 1, 0, 0 and 0, 1, 0 and 0, 0, 1. This is one set of bases. And we can have, for instance, 1, 1, 0, I don't know, 1, 0, 2, and 2, 1, 0. This is another set. Or we can make up any other sets that we want to. So, because this is a base, this is also a base, we can write down any of the u's as this form. Now, U is the same, so it means that the right hand side of the equations are the same, right? So we get C1, B1, Cn, Bn is equal to B1, D1, Bn, En. Which you can write in a vector form. Is it true?
Let me write in this.
This by C I mean the whole vector, column vector C. I write it in red because we can stick with what I have in above. Any question up to this point? Anything here? Dana? Now, E, although E, for instance, is a vector, is a basis, but still it belongs to my vector space V, isn't it? Do you agree that EI, any of the E's, belongs to V? It has to be. It's a basis, so it has to be a vector in V. So if E is a vector in V, then it means that I can write down E1 as, let's say, K11 V1 plus K12 V2 plus K1N Vn. Right? Because E1 is like U, a vector. And I use these coefficients, I mean K11, KIJ is just a single coefficient, it's a real number, which belongs to the VF. I can do the same thing for E2. 2, 1, V1. Till EN. So for all E's, I can write them as linear combination of V's. Why? Because V's are the basis. These are any vectors. Or I could write V1 as a combination of these. Doesn't really matter. K and NN Vn. So from here, it means that the vector E, which is the E1, E2, till En, is equal to this matrix, K11, KN1, K1n and Knn multiply by V. It should be V multiplied by. Right? Where E is V1, V2, En, V is V1, V2, Vn. Any question? Up to this point. I call this equation equation 1 and this equation equation 2. Or even then, let's make it before I make equation 2. Can I call whole this one a capital K, a matrix of capital K? So it will be easier to manipulate. So I write this E is equal to V capital K. So I call this one 2. So it will be easier.
easier to look at it.
So look at the equation 1 and equation 2. So what I have, VC is equal to VKB. VKB. So I multiply both sides by V inverse, so I get C is equal to KB. What is K? K is a matrix. It is a matrix of transformation of basis E to B, transformation of coefficients of basis E to B. And similarly, very easily, we can see that B is equal to K inverse of C. Now, why it is important? If I know one of the bases, if I know K, I can calculate the other bases. Or if I know both of the bases, I can calculate K. Knowing K is very useful. We do need it. If I know E, and if I know V, how can I calculate K? One way is that I can go through here, and I calculate the value root for the K. The other one is, one may calculate K, with capital K, which is a matrix, by using Gauss-Jordan method. And height is, we write V1 till Vn, we put a dash here, then we write E1 till En. We try to convert it in this form, that the left side is identity, then whatever is on the right side is K. And let's do a numerical example. And the numerical example is this. Find the matrix of transformation of bases from E to V if V1 is 1, minus 1, 1, V2 is 0, 1, 2, V3 is 3, 0, minus 1. And E1 is 1, 0, 0. E2 is 1, 0, 1. E3 is, 0. Is 0, 0, 1. Go ahead and do it. So now, so how we do it is this. You prepare this term. What was v1? 1, minus 1, 1. What was v2? 0, 1, 2. What was v3? 3, 0, minus 1. And this is e1, e2, and e3. We want to convert it into I and k. Calculate k. Yeah, this is v1, v2, v3. This is e1, e2, e3. Do you know how to do it? You know, here we want to convert this one into 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, because this is I. Now, in order to make this one, we have to do lots of adding this one with the other one, multiply it with something else, add these two columns, subtract it from another, this row and another one. But while you are doing it, you have to do the same thing in here. So at the end of the day, here on the left you have the I, whatever is left is your K. Okay, go ahead and do it. Do you understand?
This is also
very good. I like clever.
Well, indeed, I can see that you have started to subtract some of the rows and columns, but someone had a very nice observation. And the observation is this. We have V here, right? And we had E here, and this one we wanted to convert into the I and K. Because we know C is equal to KB, right? But on the other hand, we knew that B is equal to K inverse of C. What does it mean? It means that here, if you observe, can you tell me that what is E? It's already I.
Yeah.
So this is already I. So, if I want to convert this one into the I and K, you can tell me what this is?
K
inverse. So already I have the K inverse. So I know that my K inverse is 1, minus 1, 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, minus 1. How can I find K? Inverse of K inverse is K. So I calculate the inverse of all. So it will be K inverse of inverse, which is K, and it will be simply calculate the inverse of this expression. You can use a calculator to find the inverse, but the results
will be something like, so k is equal to 1 over 10 multiplied by 1 minus 6, 3, 1, 3, 4, 2, 3, minus 1. Remember, this is a very cool example in the sense that the bases E are making R. I'm not saying that what we were doing were wrong. It was absolutely correct, but sometimes we can do it faster if we have a correct observation, which shows that our E is equal to I, so you just simply need to find the inverse of this one. Do you have any question? Do you know how to calculate the inverse? Use a calculator in the exam page. Now, we talk about linear transformation, right? And we basically said we have this domain V1. We have codomain V2, which we call it also range. And we have this linear transformation A, which is a matrix, which transforms what I had from here into here. And assume the dimension of V1 is N, the dimension of V2 is M. So from N I go to M. So I want to talk about range space. Range space is the vector space which is the result of the transformation from the domain is placed. In other words, all the vectors, all the outcomes of the transformation are making a set, which we call it a range space. Range space is spanned by columns of the operator A that we have. And is the subspace of fill the blank. It's subspace of what? Is A a vector space? A is a matrix. A is the linear transformation that we have.
Of the V1, the source of the
of the V1. How many vector spaces do we have here? How many vector spaces do I have here? How many vector spaces do I have here?
Two.
V1 and V2. So, we narrow down our answers. Half of you or some of you will say V1, some of you will say V2. So your choice is?
V1.
Maybe difference something. V1, V2.
The difference between V1 and V2? V2.
V.
V. You should put an index, don't be politician.
V1. You have to pick one.
V1. Now, let's look at it from this form.
What was the name of this one? Domain. What is the name of this one? Codomain. What do I do? Copy. Look, with this matrix, I am transforming from here into here. So what is the range that I go to? V2. I start from V1, which is the domain, and I go to V2. So I'm the subspace of V2. So I don't want you to randomly pick up one, but I want you to make some logic. So from here, from the domain, we start to move to somewhere which we call it the domain, which is our range. Now what about the dimension of RA? Dimension of RA is the maximum number of independent columns of A. So if I look at the A and I find out how many independent columns I have in A, I can say that the dimension of R is that. So let's do an example to see how I can calculate the number of independent columns in A. Again, this is a numerical example. Find the range space if A is equal to 1, 1, 1, 0, 3, 4, 5, 3, then -5, -7, -9, -6, 1, 3, 5, 2, and 5, -2, -9, -1. Now, in order to find the number of independent columns in a matrix, what we need to do is we have to do an operation which is called reduction of a matrix. By reduction of the matrix, we mean that we have to write the matrix in a form which we have. Wherever we start with a 1, we should have zeros before that. We don't care about what is happening afterwards. In other words, we have to reduce the columns in the form that we have. Either we start with 1 or we start with zeros and then we have sets of 1. Now, how we can do it? Again, we can use the Gauss-Jordan method in order to reduce this matrix into whatever it is required, like 1, 0. If I subtract 1 first row from all of the other columns, what do I get? Sorry, other rows, what do I get? 0, 0, 0. Here is 3. 3 minus 4 is minus 1. 3 minus 5 is minus 2. 3 minus 3 is 0. Is minus 5, 1, 5. This minus this one is minus 2. Minus 4. Yes, plus 2, plus 4. And then it is 1. If I subtract here, I have minus 2. Minus 4, minus 1. If I subtract, I have 7, I have 14, and I have 6. Right? So this is the first. You can see that this is my first one. I have to proceed further. What I can do is, I can multiply this one, look. I multiply my R2 by R2 and I put it into R2. So what will happen? I will have like 0, 1, minus 2, plus 2, and minus 7. Do you agree with that one?
The third column is not right.
This one minus this.
Minus
7,
minus
5
is still minus
2. Minus 5, minus 5, minus 7 is like minus 5 plus 7 is 2.
I mean, you should
have
minus
7
plus
5. What I do is I write here R1 minus R2. So it is minus 5 minus minus 7 is minus 5 plus 7 is 2. You like to have second one minus first one? Okay. Then I don't need to multiply. I directly get what I wanted to get. This is 2, and this is minus 7. Right? Because if I here, Katri said that, don't do that. Do this. R2 minus R1. Very good, because I had R1 minus R2 and I had to multiply it also with minus 1, and I don't do that. No problem. It doesn't change anything. Now, next thing is I am calculating this one. I come here and I write R2, let's say minus R1. Why? Because I want to kill this one. So what happens, I will get 0. So this multiplied by 3 minus this one will make me minus 1. This multiplied by 3 is 6 minus 1 is 5. This multiplied by 3 minus this one is minus 26. So I got, this is the first one, this is the second one. So I can continue further in order to see what is happening. But
is the first column last element correct? Like 1 minus 6.
0.
No, like the second, more upper? Up. Yes, that one, the last.
This one minus this one is 0.
Yes, and the last one at the bottom.
Ah. But this is 0. Ah, I'm subtracting everything from this one.
Okay.
So R1 minus R3 and R4, R1 minus R4. I don't need to even subtract it.
Okay.
Because this one is already 0, so I can keep the values.
Okay.
Well, let's see. I have my first column ready. I have now my second column ready. Why? Because I have 0 and I have 1 in here. Now, why it is ready now? Because I know that if I multiply R2, the new by 2, and I add it by R3, this will become 0. So I don't need it anymore. I will get 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. And I have to continue and see that if I can do the same thing for here, for here, for here. But we know definitely how many columns do I have? 5. How many rows do I have? 4. I know that definitely one of them is redundant. Because we know the rank of a matrix is minimum of, its maximum number of a rank is minimum of these rows and columns. In other words, I cannot find 5 independent columns. Definitely one of them must be the result of the other ones. Now, I have to continue, but in exam you don't need to do it. You have your computer with yourself, and if you are using MATLAB, there is a comment, R and P is equal to R, R, E, F of the matrix A. And if you apply this one, it will reduce it automatically for you. And if you do it, you will get this result. You will get R is equal to, I use MATLAB, so you can see that I'm very bad in addition and subtraction. But as I stated before, if I make a mistake in class, nothing will happen. If you do, you lose one. So R is this. So it gives you R, and it gives you P is equal to 1, 2, 4. Do you know what does it mean, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 4? It means that column 3 and column 5 can be written as linear combination of column 1, column 2, and column 4. Column 1, column 2, and column 4. So can you tell me that what is the dimension of A? RA, what is the dimension of RA?
Three.
Yes, it is 3. So dimension of RA is equal to 3, and RA is span of first one, which is 1, 1, 1, 0. Second one, which is 3, 4, 5, 3. And the fourth one, which is 1, 3, 5, 2. Right? Now, a few seconds ago, I said that the number, we know that definitely at least one of them is linearly depending on the other ones. Here, we know that two of them are. And the reason is because the dimension is 4 by 5, 4 rows and 5 columns. And we know that the rank of a matrix is always less than or equal to the minimum of the size. It cannot be greater than the values. Now, so it means that let's get back to definition of the rank, which we had at the beginning of the class, and link it with the Ranger space. So we start, we define the rank. We said it tells us the number of independent column. Number of independent column. What is the dimension of RA? The dimension of RA is the maximum number of also independent columns. So you see, they are the same. So the definition goes in this form. For a non-singular matrix A, M by N, so N by N. What is the meaning of non-singular?
Has a determinant.
Determinant is not zero. The determinant is not zero. The rank of A is equal to M. For A, which is an M by N matrix, rank of A is equal to minimum of M or N, and rank of A is less than minimum of M or N. As you can see, we don't have the concept of being greater than M and N. If rank of A is the same as minimum of M and N, for instance, if this matrix has the rank to be 4, we call it is a full rank matrix. If it is full rank, it is good. We like full rank, but the problem usually happens when we don't have a full rank matrix. And if we have rank A less than minimum, we call it rank deficiency. Rank deficiency. So as you can understand, dimension of RA is equal to the rank of A. So today I talk, I make you bored, you hated me, you start to feel very bored in order to come to this last sentence. Dimension of RA is equal to rank A. So we have to go all over to get to this conclusion, which we'll be using from now. Which we'll be using in our next lecture. The class is not finished. As I promised you, you will have your second homework. Again, three questions. I will put the questions in the module. I will scan this page and I will put them in the module. But the question that you have to solve are from our book. Page 14 and 15, exercises, how many exercises? 8 exercises we have. How many do you want to solve? One? No, one is another question. Previously, how many did I give you?
Three.
Okay, so good, because I'm again giving you three. 2, 3, 5. 2, 3, 5. And at some other occasion, I will solve the other ones. They are pretty short. Okay, line. One of them is not short, but the other two are very short, like a one-line answer. The deadline, as usual, is 2 weeks. On Tuesday, we have finished. We are about to finish in chapter 3. On Tuesday, I'll give you the third homework. So. But again, you will see that that's very simple. The still big homeworks are pretty simple. How was that homework done? Any difficulty? Good. Then I can increase the level of difficulty of the homework. Okay, so you may stop the video.